which will be given by Bas Bauman. Well known to us all, he started his education in 1973 at the Lyceum Gymnasium in Wageningen. Completed his bachelor's, master's, and then PhD also at Wageningen, completing the PhD in 1991. At the same time, he undertook several courses, including Spanish, radar, negotiation, and simulation. All of these things he's tried out on his colleagues. He lists his qualifications as being tropical agriculture, irrigation, water use, water saving, sustainable land use, agroecology, systems analysis, and it goes on to a long list. So he joined the Wageningen group in 1987 and continued through there until the mid-90s, and that sort of covered all the time when there were the advances in the systems research and through the large projects such as SARP. A lot of work was done on crop modelling, using systems approaches to try and gain a better understanding of the different agricultural environments and how we might adapt the crop and the management in order to better fit those. Took a spell in Costa Rica, 1997 to 1998, and then he joined Erie as a water scientist. From when he joined the water team that was here, and that led to a sort of a series of initiatives and research programs, and then eventually outreach, where we saw sort of technologies such as alternate wetting and drying and aerobic rice being rolled out to many programs. And today, we know that sort of those are recognized as being opportunities to not only save water, but also impact on such factors such as greenhouse gas. Now, since then, Bas has made the transition from a researcher in the field to very much sort of a manager of research programs, and that's not I think so many of us we would recognise has been a sort of an easy transition, and in fact there's been sort of a number of sort of manifestations that their colleagues have had to watch and put up with to some extent, the numbers of sort of gyrations, to the extent that at some points one wonders where it was going. But in Bass's own words, he has now arrived as a clean shaven, and that highly evolved approach to life is something that he's now secured. So with that, I'd like to hand over to Bas, who's going to tell us about CRISP, whether it's met our expectations, and where do we go next. Bas, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks, David. Stella just asked me before I came here if she should come and listen to my presentation. I said, now you know what I'm doing, but having listened to David, now I regret that I said that, because actually that was very good, David, and I wish you had heard it. But maybe you can redo it at one point in time during private conversation. So, I will be talking about CRISP. Does it meet expectations, and where do we go next? Before I give the overview of my presentation, just a very quick reminder, I'm not going to explain CRISP, but there may be some newcomers here. CRISP is a CGIAR research program. In fact, it was the first established as a part of the reform process of the whole CG system, where there is more emphasis to programmatic payment for and delivery of science rather than institutional. And we also see it very much as a global partnership led by ERI, so much more than a program, a real partnership. It was founded and it is now coordinated by three CG centers, ERI, Africa Rice, obviously in Africa, and SIAD, who plays its whole rice program under the umbrella of CRISP. And then the three non-CG centers joined, and she had an IRD in France and JIRCAS in Japan. And these are three institutes who do have an international mandate from their home country and who have a substantial investment in RISE R&D. So they joined the 3CG centers to together formulate the CRISP partnership program. We shared a vision, we shared a mission, and we shared common objectives and have aligned their research along similar themes, product lines and products. And I will be telling them more about that later. And the combined value, more or less, is roughly $100 million. And that's only for the funds that flow through the 3CG centers. We haven't really teased out the contributions of CIRAD, IRD and JIRCAS yet. It started in January 2011, and it was approved by the CG system for a period of 5 years. So that's quickly the reminder about CRISP. So what I will be doing is three things. I will be trying to capture some of the elements of what we think works well, and there is a lot to say there, but I will focus on two major issues. What can be strengthened, again, two major issues, and how we are working towards CRISP-2. And it's very timely to do this now because we are entering the last phase of the last year of the approved phase one project time of CRISP next year. And we're starting to get our act together on how a CRISP phase two might look like. So it's very opportune to look back, take stock, what have we accomplished, but what also can we do better. So the management team of CRISP started addressing these issues within IRI. Matthew Morel had organized a few sessions, workshops, retreats with his senior staff, and at Africa Rise and CIAT we started doing the same. So I will be sharing some of these initial thoughts that we have at the moment, and then move into the development of CRISP-2. So when you want to ask of a program like CRISP, is it doing what it wants to do? Is it working well? You really need to dig a little bit deeper. What actually do you mean? And what we really want to answer is, what are we doing now because of CRISP that IRI as an institute or Africa Rise as an institute would not have been doing? What are we doing differently? And the main answer there must lie in the partnership. CRISP is a partnership program, an umbrella program, and it aims to make RISE R&D more efficient, more effective, and I'll come back to that one, much more impact-oriented as well. So one of the first things that came out is that really the alignment of the R&D agenda of these institutes has led to considerable added value and synergies. And without going into detail of the research that's being done, I want to flash a few of these highlights of really topics where we really are making a difference by partnering under the umbrella of CRISP. This is a slide that I borrowed from Marco Wolprijs, who showed it to the CRISP Oversight Committee just 2 weeks ago, how he sees CRISP as a mechanism of leveraging global knowledge, obviously for him, from the Africa Rise perspective. Marco Wolprijs is the Deputy Director General of Africa Rise. And he really sees CRISP as a mechanism where Africa Rise and its NARES partners in the continent can leverage and bring in outside knowledge and expertise. And here he has listed a few of the most important ones that benefit the work in Africa. And you see it's not only IRI, CIAT, R&D, CIRAD and JIRCAS, the key partners of CRISP, but through CRISP also German and Belgian universities, other institutes in Japan. And we all use the CRISP structure, the themes, its product lines and products to align and bring in these institutes to basically help get the job done in Africa. for a few specific examples, and I'll start with reading. Reading in Africa by national systems is not as developed as it is here in Asia. There are only a handful of readers in the whole continent, and there are very poorly developed seat systems. There is very there's much less quality control in the whole reading pipeline than we are used to here in Asia. So what Africa Rise and its partners have established is an Africa-wide reading task force, and it's built on a model that Africa Rise already ran a few decades ago, that then got abandoned because mainly budget constraints, but that got reinvigorated. And the idea is that you see here at the bottom the Africa Rise Reading Task Force that operates a number of multi-environment trials where any partner, whether it's from Africa Rise, from the NAVIS, or here in Africa, or even SIAP outside of Africa, can nominate reading lines which should have some minimum quality and quantity of accompanying data, and that can then be accepted and enter into these multi-environment testing set. So this is a set sites across Africa where under controlled conditions these lines are being tested. Then out of that testing network, if varieties are promising and doing well, they can receive a nomination from the task force that goes by the name ARICA. Now in itself, this task force, or Africa Rise, who leads it, cannot release varieties. But if it has gone through the system of multi-location testing, if it has been endorsed by the task force, which has members from all the countries, then it is a seal of quality, some guarantee that will facilitate adoption and release by in different countries. It doesn't mean that this is a mechanism that has to be followed. You see the arrows at the side. Of course, if IRI or SIAD or any other partners gets good material in its own breeding program, there's absolutely no reason why that cannot or should not be released by any of the partners in any of the countries. So it's an added quality control step that this mechanism provides. And the good thing is it's working. Here we see the entries of the different partners, and before the task force was initiated, we see that the bulk of the material that was available came from Africa Rise and NAVIS partners. But we see already in 2012 that nearly half of the material that started flowing into this network actually came from IRI. The proportion of material from SIAD was very high in 2011. So we see that, yes, this task force under the umbrella of CRISP is harnessing genetic resources from all over the globe to the advantage of Africa. And if we see at the nominations of ARICAs coming out of this task force mechanism this year, there are two that come from IRI, have an IRI background, and I think now the teller stands at something like 9 of these ARICA varieties actually having been approved and are scheduled for release in a number of countries of Africa. So I think a very powerful mechanism that brings together the different breeding entities, not only in Africa, but also outside of Africa, very much part of the IRI spirit. Sticking to breeding, we all know the history of hybrid rice here in Asia and at IRI. And a few years, the new Hybrid Rice Research and Development Consortium was launched with a real sustainable business model behind it. And Latin America followed suit, and developed its own hybrid rice consortium a couple of years ago, and not exactly the same mechanism, but very much inspired by the IRI model. And the hybrid rice breeders really connect well. And you'll see when you go, this is myself pointing there in the middle of the picture. We're standing in the middle of Peru at a breeding site managed by Hacienda Potrero, which is a private sector breeding entity in the middle of Peru. And here we have material from a funding Chies hybrid rice consortium being tested there in Peru. So there's lots of material flowing through the hybrid rice consortia, through the connections between the breeders, the hybrid rice breeders that Chris has facilitated. And not only is there material flowing into Latin America and being tested, but there's also promising lines from SIAD to IRI being tested here, and not only at IRI, but also shared with his partners. And I visited a number of sites in Peru, in Colombia, and Nicaragua, and all the sites where I visited, I saw IRI material being tested, and even some of the African material being tested. Phenotyping network, I don't have to say very much about this, because I think that Michael Dinkum recently gave a seminar, a presentation on this. But this is again a network very much part of CRISP. It is a global network where institutions working on breeding realize that it's the phenotyping capabilities that are posing a bottleneck to exploiting to full advantage the richness of the genomic revolution that we are seeing. And they are bundling their forces and testing material, same material, under different conditions, different climatic conditions, and testing material for high yield conditions in certain environments, for stress prone and stresses in other environments, sharing protocols to do that, sharing data coming out of these experiments, and actually sharing ideas on a whole load of novel instrumentation technologies to fastly phenotype. And when you visit the site at Santa Rosa and at SIAD headquarters, you see a lot of investment and thinking on novel instrumentation and fast phenotyping that's also happening here at IRI. And again, a lot of cross-fertilization, including some of the advanced research institutes on this slide. But there's more than breeding alone. And there is quite often things are happening that have been initiated and are sparked by the collaboration under CRISP, and we don't even know about it. And that is something I will come back later. This is a slide that I picked up at SIAD 2 months ago when I visited. Last week here at IRI, Tauli and his team gave another training course on the crop growth simulation model Horizon 2000. That's a computer model, and if you feed it with information on a variety characteristics, on weather and soil type, it makes a prediction of the growth in terms of biomass, leaf area index, and yield you can expect. And IRI has been taking the lead together with Wageningen University already since the mid-1980s in developing these model capabilities for rice and actually training others and getting a whole community of practice involved. And there were trainees from SIAD and from Uruguay last year, and I think yes, actually they were in the audience, who got trained in this model and now started applying it for very specific case studies in Colombia. What we see here, the map of Colombia in the black dots, we see experimental sites where under well-controlled conditions and a number of carefully chosen treatments, the model is being calibrated and will be used to answer a very specific question. It seems that for the last couple of years in Colombia, yields and productivity is actually going down. And the Colombian government is very concerned about that and wants to know why is it happening, at such a large scale. So with the model being calibrated on 1 or 2 years of data collected in different environments, with such a model, you can then actually start disentangling other climatic factors that are responsible for the declining yield and productivity. What if we look at future climate scenarios? What if we would change certain management characteristics such as sowing date, seed density, or length of the growing season? What would that do to help mitigate or counter the reduction in yield potential? So a direct transfer in this case of a technology developed in one CRISP institute to one other. In fact, there are more institutes involved in Colombia to answer very specific questions. Another example, again, on modeling, this time in Africa. You may know that IRI, through the work of Sergi Savary especially, and Laetitia, his wife, years ago, led to development of models that were able to predict risks of pest outbreaks related to climatic conditions, and other models that say, well, if this is a pest pressure, this is the expected or could be anticipated effect and impact on yield, rice pest and AP rice. And these models are now used at Africa Rice to indeed explore particularly what future climates hold in store in relation to pest and disease incidences and their impacts on rice yield. I won't go into detail, but the different maps are for the river Tanzania, and in different colors you see with different future climate scenarios what the impact of BLB diseases would be on rice. And the more red it is, the worse off you are, and the greener, the better off you are. I don't want to go into detail per se, but again, it's an example of transfer of technologies being very successfully adopted by other of the CRISP institutes. Nutrient management and crop management advice. Roland Boerisch and his team started to collaborate with the nutrient and crop management staff of Africa Rice maybe 6-7 years ago, and we were still talking about nutrient manager applying principles of site-specific nutrient management, collecting the required data under African conditions in different countries, calibrating the model. And that collaboration has endured until now, and Africa Rice is also in the mode of developing a crop advice system and using cell phone technology to deliver it. In this case, because of different conditions in Africa, they are developing their own particular software, but the whole philosophy and the principle came out of that collaboration between IRI and Africa Rice. And the Africa Rice advice prototype that you see here is very similar in look and functionality as the crop manager that IRI is developing. So again, I think a very successful example of cross-pollination under CRISP over the institutes, among the institutes. Again, another example, rice mapping. I think all of you are very aware of the work that Andy Nelson and his team here are doing in different projects, most notably the RISE and the PRISM project, where they are looking at the use of remote sensing, specifically radar remote sensing that can look through the clouds and observe what's happening on the surface of the Earth, GIS, crop modeling, again in this case, ORISA 2000, and expert knowledge, and bring that together to create maps where you can actually in real time get a very good idea of the area planted under rice, the crop stage, the cropping calendar of rice, and even actual yield standing in the field. And if you look, take some weather forecasts into consideration, actually make predictions of what yield could be 1 or 2 months from now, given certain expectations of weather. Again, a technology, it's really a cutting-edge technology, being also now adopted by Africa Rise, and there has been a lot of interaction between the GIS labs, really clicks very well, and they are with more modest means still at this stage, but using the same technologies with success in Africa. So I can go on and on. There are so many examples that we really came to the conclusion that yes, this part of CRIS is working very well. Of course, we can always do more, but we are really inspired by these examples, and we really need to flesh them out in the years ahead. The second major highlight of where we think CRIS is successful is also it's in the whole putting the work into the impact thinking and much more on impact pathways, developing theories of change to put our research really into the for development resulting into outcome orientation. And it's maybe not that new for IRI, and those of you who have been here as long as David Johnson and myself, you remember Debbie Templeton, who was here from ACR and helped us in getting our mindsets on impact pathways, and that was already probably some 8 to 9 years ago. But within CRIS, we are taking that further and giving it a much more structural approach. So when we look at CRIS, when it was designed 5 years ago, it had this mission, which is very recognizable, very much the CGIAR mission: reduce poverty and hunger, improve health and nutrition, and make sure that we don't spoil the environment while we do that. To be a little bit more specific, it had objectives in it. We want to increase rice productivity, and it says how we're going to do that with breeding and technology development. We want the systems to be more sustainable and more resource use efficient, and already quite new at the time, looking at the rice sector as a whole. So where we started much more looking at, here at IRI, the type of work that Sam Mohanty is doing, providing and analyzing the whole rice sector, analyzing trade, supply, demand, and looking at how we can support the rice sector as a whole. We took that further, and this was also a process driven by the CGIAR as a whole, and underneath that developed, this is an outcome that was produced last year with all the theme leaders involved, be even more specific, and these are called development outcomes. In CG speak, even IDOs, intermediate development outcomes. But you see, we again try to be more specific, increase production, and there is a local and global aspect here. We look at profitability of rice producers that we want to get up, to lift them out of poverty. But we are also specific that we also address the poor net rice consumers. So we need to increase affordability to them. So we have a whole list, 7 of them. You see at the bottom that we really start taking gender very seriously, and it's one of the 7 outcomes that we all need to work towards in the work that we're doing. Even more important, we started to really explicitly develop impact pathways with supporting theories of change. And here is just a generic one. This came out of a series of workshops that we had last year here at IRI at Africa Rise, then combined with all the theme leaders, with professional facilitators, and we really looked at, okay, suppose that out of the research at the bottom, we develop a new variety. And we think it's a good variety, it has tolerance against or for or off